the or the video. Okay, so I already mentioned. So I think that the point that I want to highlight the most is on the population and also the sampling. How do you actually determine the minimum sample size? Okay, for example, from thesis number 23, okay, this thesis was done using UUM, SBM, School of Business Management, as the population, okay, and the use of the Krejci and Morgan table, okay, from to determine what is the what is the minimum what is the this one Okay, yeah, this is number 20. Okay, this is number 20 on the entrepreneurial intention. So this thesis was done based on the population of SBM students, School of Business Management, okay, under COB. Okay, so in that video, I already mentioned how you can actually use the Krejci and Morgan table, which I already uploaded in your OL, okay, last Monday. It's just a simple table. If you Google Krejci and Morgan 1970, you should find a table something like this. So N will be the population size. S will be the minimum sample required. Okay. Minimum means you can get, you can have more than that. Okay. The more the better lah. But the minimum sample required that you need to take, if the population, let's say, is let's say 1,000, what will be the minimum? So let's say the population is 1,000, you need to get at least 278 respondent or samples from the population, okay, and so forth lah. So the thesis that I think used for the discussion in that video was thesis number 20, okay, whereby the student did a study on SBM students. And there are in total there are 2,529 students. Okay, so from these 2529, using the table, the minimum required sample that you need to get will be 335. So in your own study, in your own project, okay. So I know, so I already gone through, I think, almost all of your chapter one draft. One thing that I need to point out, okay, which I think at least I think at this stage of your semester, most of you are semester five. Whenever you submit a project, whether an assignment, a draft, make sure at least you provide a cover page, meaning that provide the title, your group names, your group number, your metric number, and whatnot. The standard template for cover page, okay, the name of your group, the metric number, and so forth. So I noticed some of the group did not even bother to prepare a simple cover page. Okay, just go straight to the discussion of your chapter one. Okay, so don't be that lazy lah, okay, to provide a simple cover page for your. So in the upcoming submission for your chapter number two, which I, okay, the instruction I think I will put up today, submit the draft for chapter number two by end of next week, okay, before you go for the semester break. So whenever you submit any draft of chapter, okay, or whatever submission, okay, provide the cover page, okay, meaning your group name, the title, and metric number, and whatnot. Okay, so okay, going back to this particular thesis, okay, so this thesis number 20 was done on the SBM student. So whatever project that you propose, okay, so let's say you are focusing on UUM students, the whole of UUM undergraduates. So you need to know what is the actual number of UUM students at present, meaning as per this semester. So how are you going to get that information? That is for you to find out lah, okay. You need to contact whether you want to contact the HEP or HEA, whatever department you want to ask the office. Okay, contact whichever person that you need to do. So that is your responsibility to determine what is the actual population size. If you are focusing on UUM SCFB students, so you need to determine what is the actual number of SCFB students. Okay, especially because we have only four courses like economy, agribusiness, finance and banking. So something like this. Okay, so this is the only actual or the only real data that you provide. Okay, the questionnaire that you design, the respondent does not need to be the actual respondent. Meaning that, okay, I mentioned this many times, you can answer, you can let your friends answer, meaning that they can become the respondent even though they are not the actual sample. Okay, so that part is already easy for you all to do. Okay, but for the population frame, what is the actual population size? That information must be the true information. So if some of the, I think one of the project that I read, okay, you are focusing on, I think on lodging in Kelantan, okay, about the spending behavior, something like that, okay. So you need to determine what is the actual number of people, okay, or residents living in that area. Okay, so whatever information or source of information, for example, if you focusing on UMSEFB, okay, so the number of students must be obtained from the from UUM lah, whether from SAB department or from the whatever information. So you need to mention the source lah, okay, so that if I want to verify that the number is, so you cannot simply create the number on your own lah. So this the number of population must be the correct value. Okay, so if you are focusing on UUM COB, okay, so how many COB students are in total? Okay, COB student mean we have several school under COB. School of Accounting, School of Economics, Finance Banking, School of SBM, okay, School of whatever school. I mean, I think there are six schools or seven schools under COB. So you need to get the total population for all of the schools combined under COB. Okay, so where are you going to get that information from? You need to figure out yourself lah. Okay, make phone call. Okay, if you need to contact the school dean or whatever information. Okay, so you can. That is the only part where I need you to do actual research. Okay, determine the actual population value. Okay, so depending on the topic, if you're focusing on, I think one of the group did focus on Petaling Jaya, if I'm not mistaken. Okay, so you need to find out what is the, okay, what is the number of residents or group of people that you are, if you're focusing on B40, so you need to know how many B40s people are registered or belong, okay, in that area that you are doing the study. Okay, so that is one thing that I want to highlight, okay, on the previous video. So under the population frame, okay, under the population frame, so you need to determine lah what is the, I mean, under the sampling and sampling technique, okay, so the sample that you want to obtain, what is the minimum sample size? This one can be obtained determined using the Krejci and Morgan. So that one I think is quite easy, okay, but the part that you need to do a bit of study is what is the actual population size according to the topic of your choice. Okay, so that is your part lah to investigate. Okay, so once you have determined the actual population value, okay, compare that value, I mean, use that value and using the Krejci and Morgan table. Okay, and then you should be able to determine what is the minimum sample size. Okay, so this sample size, for example, in this particular thesis, 335 respondents. So meaning that there should be 335 respondents at least, okay, that should answer the questionnaires of your for your study. So of course you can do this among your group members, okay, ask your friend, because of course this is quite, I mean, if you divide according to your group members, meaning one student only need to get around, you know, maybe around 70 respondent. Okay, so you all fikir lah macam mana, how are you going to get this number, okay? Ask your friend ke, or you want you among yourself answer so many questions ke, whatever lah. Okay, but the respondent should reflect the the size of the population. But I think if you refer to the Krejci and Morgan table, okay, if you are focusing, the sample size will just be around 300 something. Okay, even for a 20,000 respondent, okay, for example like this, okay, you only require around 377 samples, okay. So no matter how big your sample size is, I mean your population, the number will just be around this range. So it will not be much different. Okay, so how are you going to answer them? You want to fill up the form yourself or whatever lah. Okay, ask your friend to answer, ask other group members. Okay, ask your parents, your Facebook friends or whatever lah. As long as you reach the number of questionnaires being answered lah. So that will be the, so when you key in Instata, sorry, in SPSS, okay, which I already provided you the link how to install. So you need to have this number of samples, okay, in your project. Okay, so that is something that you need to focus on lah. Okay, so you can do the data collection or filling up the questionnaire during the semester break. Okay, so and then okay, learn on how to use SPSS. So I will show you how to use SPSS briefly lah, maybe next Monday. Okay, and then the rest you can learn from YouTube. There are so many online videos from YouTube that teaches you how to use SPSS. So it's not really a difficult software to learn, especially if you are only using the simple analysis. Okay, so the video which I recorded last Monday, I stopped until this particular section on the sampling. So I also mentioned on the use of convenient sampling. Okay, convenient sampling means this is, I think, the most popular technique to obtain your sample. Meaning, convenient means what is easy for, how the method that is easiest or the most at your convenient, yang paling senang for you to get the correspondent lah. Meaning, if you want to ask, if your sample belong to SAAB students, okay, in the real world, if you want to get respondent from SAAB, so just simply send the link to all SAAB students, and whomever answer first, okay, or that respond, that will be your respondent lah, will be your sample lah. Okay, so you don't have any specific, for example, you want student must come from economy, some student must come from agri, some student must come from finance or banking. Okay, convenient is whomever that you can get the information from that respond to your request when you send the link. Okay, so that is the method of choice lah. So I think this is the easiest approach. So in fact, I think many of the students, okay, even for master's thesis, the one that you get from the library, for example, like this one also using convenient sampling. Okay, this is also using convenient sampling. So I believe everyone, every group, okay, may use this approach as well. Okay, convenient sampling. Of course, in the real world scenario, there are more than one technique lah. You can use cluster sampling, stratified sampling, okay, or simple random sampling. Okay, so we're not going to discuss too much in detail. Okay, because unless if we were to learn face by face to face, and your exam is based on the conventional exam, meaning you write, I mean you have questions at the end of the semester to answer during actual exam, then we need to go through some of this definition lah. What is cluster sampling? What is stratified sampling? Okay, what is convenient sampling? Okay, what is snowball sampling? So these are the different methods of sampling. Okay, but most of the time, students will prefer to use the convenient sampling because it is the easiest one to do, and it doesn't have any restriction. Meaning anyone can answer your question as long as they belong to the population. So for example, if your population is COB students, so anyone from COB can answer the questions, okay? Whether they are from SCAB, they are from accounting, they are from SPM, doesn't really matter. Okay, as long as they belong under COB. Okay, so your part, okay, your responsibility for chapter number 3 Okay, is to obtain the actual number of population. Okay, so figure out how you are going to get this information. Okay, if you are doing something outside UUM, so you need to check maybe the Department of Statistics. Okay, contact whichever authority that you think can give you the information. Okay, because that information is not confidential. You just want the number, the total number of people or companies, okay, or B40 in that particular area. So that information shouldn't be that difficult to obtain. Okay, even for UUM students, if you want the number of UUM SCAB students, maybe you can just contact our office. Okay, and if you need to write a simple letter, then just write a simple letter. Okay, and if you want, but maybe you can just email the department, okay, the office, or just give a phone call and see lah whether they can, they can give you the information, or you need to call. I mean, this is your part of learning process lah. You need to know lah who are you going to call, or you need to contact, okay, write email or whatever. Okay, if you want to write a letter that I need to sign, for example, then by all means, you can forward the letter to me. If you need to contact, for example, the office, okay, and you want to write a formal letter to get the actual number of students, okay, and that letter must be signed by the lecturer, for example, in this case, must be signed by me, then just forward the letter to me, and you can use that letter to contact the relevant person lah, to give you the information. Okay, so that is the part that I want you to actually focus. Okay, get the actual data or information. Okay, and then continuing from the sampling technique though. Okay, the next part will be the questionnaire design, which I think which is the main section lah. Okay, which is the main component or the main tool that you are going to use to obtain the data for your study. Okay, so I think I mentioned this many times. Okay, whatever topic that you propose, make sure you have a sample of questionnaires. Okay, one set of questionnaire or two set of questionnaires from different journals, as long as you can use that as the guideline how you want to you can use that for your study. Okay, that should be fine, but you need to do some modification lah, some changes, so that it will reflect the current title or the current topic of your project. Okay, especially now we are in the COVID-19 season, so you might want to ask to add few questions that are related to COVID-19 in your questionnaire. Okay, as long as that questions are relevant and should provide you with that help you to answer your research questions, so you can add few more questions. So this is what I want to see, because don't just simply copy and paste from the original questionnaire and you don't do any changes at all. Okay, because any questionnaire you need to do some modification, okay, to reflect that it is more relevant to your particular study lah. Okay, so if you're focusing on COB student, so maybe some of the wordings, okay, the structure of the questions, okay, especially if you are adding something on COVID-19, government assistance or whatever lah, that must be included in the questionnaire as well. So in any questionnaire, I think by now you should get the idea already. Okay, any questionnaire, okay, you will have this standard template, meaning that the first part of any questionnaire usually will have this demographic information. Okay, this part here. Demographic profile information. So this is where you want to get as many or as much information about the respondent. Okay, so if you are focusing on students, for example, SAB students, so you might want to ask, of course lah, age, gender, race, and then the background of education. Okay, and maybe you can also add, for example, the CGPA, for example, what is the latest CGPA or pointer. Okay, as long as that information you think can help you to understand better or help you to answer your research question. Okay, maybe, for example, if you're talking about entrepreneurial intention, okay? So maybe student with high pointer is more than has more tendency to involve in entrepreneurial activity, for example. Student with lower pointer are not really interested to get involved in entrepreneurial activity. Okay, so these are the things that you may be able to find. Okay, of course, when you answer the questions, okay, they try to send the questions to maybe to your friends, meaning that try to give the question to as many of your friends as possible, so that at least you can get some good information when they answer your questionnaire. Okay, so if you're focusing on COB, on SCAB students, so you need also to get some kind of information like this. Okay, for example, the student who are answering the question, that does he or she belongs to economics department or agribusiness, okay, or from finance or banking. So the best, the ideal way is to get respondent from every department, meaning or from every program. Meaning that you might, do not have all the sample come from the same course or program. Okay, for example, if you are focusing on SCAB, okay, make sure that the respondents come from all courses, finance, banking, agri, and also economics. Okay, not 80% all from economy, because when you are focusing on COB on SCAB, because we got different departments, so you want the sample to be quite balanced. Okay, quite balanced means some must come from here, from here, from here, from here. Okay, you can use the ratio, the percentage of student. How many students come from economics? Okay, how many percent of students from the total SCAB come from economics? Okay, how many percent? So maybe your questionnaire also can be based on that percentage. So let's say from the 300 respondent, if you are required to get 300 respondent, so from these 300, how many percent of the student are from SCAB, are from economy? So let's say they are economic student is around 40% of students in SCAB. So 40% is the ratio of economic student. Okay, so meaning that your respondent from the 300 respondent, 40% should come from economics department. So this is one of the ways that you can use to actually get more balanced information, okay, or balance your respondents. Okay, not all come from one department or one course only. So any questionnaire, the first part will always be about the demographic. So if you're asking about the cost of living among B40, so you might need to get questions about the, for example, what is the occupation, whether they are government sector, private sector, or self-employed, for example. So any questions, usually you can refer to many questionnaires, okay, especially the thesis that you are referring to. Okay, just follow the standard template, the standard questions when it comes to the demographic. Okay, and then you can add a few more if you want. Okay, as long as if you add more questions, it will help you to answer your research questions or provide more information about the background of your student, of your sample, that should be fine. Okay, for example, here in this particular questionnaire, there is no question on the CGPA, the pointer. Okay, so maybe one question: what is your current or latest CGPA? Okay, so you can just put a one box. So the participant, the respondent can just fill up the form, fill up the value 3.3, for example, or you can just provide the range. Okay, 2.0 to 2.5. Okay, 2.5 to 3.0. You can have the something like this. Okay, in term of range as well. Okay, so you can put second lower, second upper, first class pointer, or whatever. Okay, so that is one of the things that you can do to improve or get more information from your respondent. Okay, so that is about section A. And then the next section will just be focusing on the components, the main components of your questionnaire. And I think usually The most popular style of question will be in term of Likert scale. Okay, Likert scale means LI, I mean to spell will be LI, okay, K, ERT, okay, Likert. So Likert scale means question that you design based on scale 1 to 5, okay, or sometimes you can even have 1 to 7, but the most common one will be up to 5 scale lah, okay. And usually scale number 5 is the most strongest one, okay, strongly agree, and then here will be strongly disagree. So and then whatever question that you, okay, put in the questionnaire, okay, the respondent need to answer based on the scale lah, whether they agree or do not agree, okay. So in this particular thesis, the section is divided according to the variables or objective of the study. I mean the variables that are affecting the entrepreneurial activity. So it depends on what is the topic of your study. Okay, again, if you got the sample questionnaire from past thesis, past journals, just follow them lah. Okay, but you can also add some new questions. Okay, you can add maybe 1 or 2 more questions that is related, let's say, to COVID-19 issue. Okay, as long as that question is clear and it will help you actually to get more information which is relevant to the current situation now. Okay, about COVID-19. If you have any questions or information that you want to know related to COVID-19 lah. For example, how does COVID-19 affect your spending behavior, for example, because you are staying at home, okay, you cannot go shopping, window shopping and whatnot. So how does, during the lockdown, okay, how does it actually affect your spending attitude or spending behavior? So these are the questions that I want to see being added in your questionnaire, because at least you can do, these are your contribution or the modifications that you do to reflect the current scenario that we are living right now in the COVID-19. Okay, so you can add 1 or 2 questions. Okay, don't add too many questions lah, depending on as long as you think that the information is useful, relevant, okay, to your objective. Okay, so and you need to pay attention to the wordings of the questionnaire. For example, like this, you can see that every word started by the word I. Okay, I. So if you want to add question on this particular section, okay, you might want to use the same style, meaning you start with the word I lah. Okay, but and then if you go through another section, for example, I will. So you might want to start another question by the word I will as well. So, and this carry on lah to other sections. Okay, so the choice of words, how you want to start the sentence, okay, you must look at as many questionnaires as possible. Okay, the question should be consistent in the style of writing, clear, and people can understand. The first time they read, the question should be clear already. Okay, so this is what I want to see lah, okay, in your sample, in your questionnaire design. Okay, so the questions can be in, I would prefer to have it in dual language lah, Malay and English. Meaning that for submission purpose, okay, even though the question is being answered in Malay, okay, but you need to have the 2 versions lah, Malay and English but if you want everything in Malay pun tak apa, okay, but if you want the question to be dual languages, meaning that Malay and English, is also okay, but not only in Malay. Okay, you can have it only in English or Malay and English lah. Okay, because our study is done in English, so I will expect the question also to be written in English lah. Okay, so that is one thing that you need to take note. Okay, when you are designing your questionnaire. So this is, as I mentioned even before, okay, do not create the question from 0, meaning you need to have a sample questionnaire, one set of questionnaires from past thesis or past journals, okay, because whatever that you submitted to me so far on chapter number 1, Meaning that I assume everyone has a sample of at least one set of questionnaire that you will be using as your main reference. Okay, how to, what do you want to ask? Okay, so that whatever research questions that you already designed in chapter one, you can have, you already have the sample questions. What do you need to ask? Okay, in the questionnaire. Okay, so I already mentioned this many times. So do not, come to me and then say, okay, I don't have any questionnaire. So because if you don't have any questionnaire, it's difficult to start from zero. Okay, because you need to think of so many things, and I don't have the time to check every single question. Okay, that you are creating on your own. Okay, so that's why unless we are learning face to face. Okay, I can just go and check during class time. Okay, but now because of this working from, online based learning, it's a bit difficult, okay, to help and guide you what do you need to do, because everything must be done through online. So it's a bit time consuming for me to check and correct them for you, lah. Okay. So at the end of next week, okay, besides submitting the draft for chapter number 2, I also need the draft for your questionnaire. Okay, because I need to look at your sample questionnaire first before you start doing your data collection. So I will assume many of the groups or all of the groups, okay, might want to use the 1 week semester break, okay, to start doing your data collection, meaning you start sending your questionnaire to your friends, okay, fill up the questionnaire according to the minimum sample size. Okay, so but I before you can do before you start sending your questionnaire, I want to have a look at your questions first. Okay, so maybe the first few days during the semester break, I will go through the questionnaire, and if I find it you need to do a bit of modification, okay, or you need to add more questions, I will just put a note there. Okay, so you need so whatever questions that you want to ask, preferably based on what other people have used, okay, in their past theses or past journals. Okay, so whatever research questions that you already planned to already submitted to me, that will be the questions that you written down, okay, should be able to be answered using the questionnaires that you have already. Okay, so that is what I've been mentioning all this while. Okay, there are some groups I think you need to modify or update or change your research question, because I don't even understand what you are trying actually to measure or to answer actually. Okay, I think one or two groups, but I think overall my biggest complaint is the referencing, meaning when you cite your article in the thesis. Okay, I already mentioned this in the previous two lectures. The correct way to cite article, one author, two authors, three authors, et al. Or not et al. Okay, the use of small letter or capital letter. So I noticed many groups are still doing this obvious mistake. Okay, so I'm not sure whether you are paying attention or not. Okay, so in chapter number 2, the draft of your literature review. So this is where you, I want to see the correct way of citing articles, okay, in your thesis. Okay, do not simply create your own style of writing or style of citing articles. Go and check my video again, okay, go and check past thesis, past journals, see how the citation is being done. Okay, you cannot have all capital letter in as the name of the author. I never teach you that in the class. Okay, so whatever, and then you only write the surname, not the full name of the authors. Okay, I never teach you how that you need to have all the names of the person. Let's say my name is Mukriz Israf Azman Aziz. You don't write my name in full. Okay, if you are citing my name in your article, okay, or in your thesis, you only write my surname, which may be just Azman Aziz, for example, or Aziz. Okay, so how it appear in the reference, that is how you actually should cite the name in your thesis lah, okay, in your project. So I already shown you many examples. Okay, you can refer to the thesis on in the Google Drive, how to properly write the name of the article, okay, the author's name in your thesis lah, in chapter 1, chapter 2 and the rest. Okay. So, any other questions?
Yes, Dr. Dr. I have two questions. First, about the letter of data permission. Before that, can you hear my voice?
Yes. Carry on.
Yeah. Okay, first about the okay, if we go to our portal, there is a letter of data permission that provided in our portal. So my question is, it we can use that letter of data permission, but I already opened that letter. On the letter, there only have one name of student, which is usually on the letter of data permission, we have all of our class name, but they only have one person in that letter of data permission.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's okay. I mean, if you can just submit one, I mean, if you got like 5 members in one group, just one person can submit, okay? And if you need my signature, for example, I can just, I mean, sign, I mean, just give you a digital punya signature lah, if that is required. But if not, then just use whatever template that you have in your portal, okay, to submit lah, let's say to the school or to the local government agency, depending on the scope of your ni lah. So your group buat dekat mana, which topic are your group, I mean, what is your population of the study? UM, is it?
Yeah, UM only.
UM what? UM, the whole of UM or just UM SAB?
The whole UM.
So maybe you can ask our school first, see whether the penolong, I mean the admin can help you lah to get the total number of students in UM. Okay, and see, because I think they got the information also, even though you are not focusing only on SAB. Okay, try our admin first, and because that information is not confidential, meaning unless you are trying to get the email number, that one maybe they cannot give lah. But just to get the total number of students, I think even our department, our own admin, okay, our own office should be able to help you with that lah. Or kalau perlu, just send the email. I mean, the template that you are doing a project under ni lah, BER3043, okay, under my ni lah, under my name. So yelah, if the letter requires some signature ke apa ke, so just send me on the WhatsApp je lah, or in my email.
Okay, letter. Okay, my second.
Only one person lah need from the group need to submit lah. No need to have all five names in the group. Because it doesn't really matter whether you are doing group or individual project, okay? What is required is the official request. You need to officially request that information. Okay, tak boleh main telefon, just give a phone call and suddenly ask what is the total number of students. That is not the way to get information lah.
Okay, thank you, Dr. I have my second question is about how minimum number of question that the one in our survey.
Repeat again.
How much minimum number of question that we need to provide in our question?
I already mentioned using the Cauchy and Morgan table tu from the video from last Monday tu. Mesti belum tengok lagi ni.
I mean question that we need.
Let's say SAB UM student 20,000. So 20,000, you are looking around 377 respondent. Meaning that, you know, the question must be answered by at least 377 student lah.
I mean the question in our questionnaire, we put the question like
how many questions you need to have?
Like this. So how many questions that we need to have, minimum number of questions?
There is no minimum or maximum, you know. That's why when you go through this exam, this past thesis, past journals, you know, whatever questions that you find, I mean, usually under one section, for example, here, you can have like 5-6 questions under one category. So it depends, you know. I cannot say that one section should only have like three, maximum three, or minimum three, or minimum five. It doesn't work that way. So some section may have more, some section may have less. But I think if you go through as many example of questionnaire, then you will get the idea what is the how many pages. Sometimes we go by pages, how many page of the questionnaire, not the number of items, because usually maybe around 3, 4, 5 pages of questionnaire. But it depends on the but you know, if you look at this particular thesis, in terms of number of pages, I think just 1, 2, okay, only three, even only three sections, okay, three pages. But sometimes maybe you may need up to 3 to 4, 4 to 5 pages of questions, depending on your questions, like your research questions. Okay, so I cannot say that, you know, only 3 pages or 4 pages. Okay, but how many questions that you need to have? Because if you write your questions in a small letter, meaning font size 10, then maybe your page number becomes lebih sikit lah. Okay, so go and check, you know, past thesis, past journals, how many questions, what are the standard number of questions. So you want your questionnaire to be around that same numbers lah. I mean, that same number of questions lah. Okay.
Okay.
So that's
okay.
I've given you. I mean, you can check online, just type, you know, contoh soal selidik. It can be in Malay as well. So you need to translate that into English in your submission. Okay. So, you know, contoh borang soal selidik, example of questionnaire. So you will find many, many, many examples online and see the, you know, the typical standard number of questions lah, bilangan soalan, berapa muka surat, how many pages. So not too long lah, but not too short. Okay, for example, for me, even this one is a bit too short for me. Okay, because the demography can be, you can have more information on the demography. Okay, because I think the demography is a bit too, sometimes you can even split the page into two, meaning like this one, only one page and one column. So usually we split the question in the page into two columns for the demography, meaning that you can have more questions in one page. Okay, but for Likert scale, yes, Likert scale only one page, one column, meaning that one, you know, you don't split the page into half lah, because then the box become too small. Okay, but for demography, you can have like two columns in one page lah. Okay, so depending on the number of questions. Okay, so I cannot say for sure how many pages, okay, how many questions. Okay, that's why I need to see the sample questionnaire first. If I find it a bit too short, then I will just put a note there. Okay, add more questions ke apa ke in your project tu lah. Okay, boleh
eh? Yeah, that, thank you, that clear.
Okay, for example, this particular thesis, but this is from a PhD thesis lah. Of course, PhD, then it require more questions lah. Okay, so for example, like this one, this is about the PTPTN loan, the, you know, factor, how whether they want to pay or not the PTPTN scholarship. Okay, so for example, like this, okay, you can see there are more information. Okay, but because we are asking students about the background of the family, okay, whether the family are working as, you know, what is the income of the parents. And then, so for example, for one section, let's say they have up to 6 questions for each section. 1 to 6, 1 to 6. This is 4 questions per section. Section D, up to 6 questions, 7 questions per section. This one up to 7 questions. This one up to 5. Okay, this one up to 7 questions, up to 10 questions, yeah. So depending on the section, I cannot say that, you know, one section should have at least 5 questions, but Usually 5 or 6 tu is the minimum lah. Okay, 7 tu is already, I think, a lot of questions already. Maybe the last section, which is something to do maybe on government policy. Okay, that one maybe you can have more questions lah. Okay, but this is for at PhD level. So at PhD, maybe you have more questions that you need to ask lah. That is one. At master's level, you can see that there's only like 5 questions for each of the 4 to 5 questions for each of the component. This one only 4 questions. Okay, this one you got like 6 questions because the question is a bit quite straightforward and very short, so it's easy to answer and it doesn't take a lot of time. Okay, but if the question is quite long, for example like this one, you need to read maybe the sentence twice for you to understand what the question is about. Then if the sentence is a bit too long, maybe you want to have less question. Okay, like this one, I think it's very short and very simple to understand. So you don't even need to read this part twice. Okay, it's only like 7 or 8 words in one sentence. Okay, so if the question is very short, maybe you can have more questions in one section. If the question is a bit too long for every section, for that particular section, then maybe you want to have less question. So these are the thing that you need to balance lah, because you must remember when student people are answering the questionnaire, they don't want to spend too much time answering the question. Usually maximum will be around 10 minutes. That is already long lah to spend for one questionnaire. Okay, you want to spend maybe less than 10 minutes per questionnaire. Okay, in order to, so you can time yourself how long do you take to answer the question from the demography until you reach the last question. So I think for a question like this, for this particular topic, okay, on this example, I think you can finish all the question in less than 5 or 6 minutes. Okay, maybe even less. Okay, so I'll be looking something around that range lah. Okay. 3 pages, 4 pages maximum. Okay, any other questions? So make sure that I think the part that you need to get the actual data is the population value. Okay, so if you are doing something outside UUM, so make sure you know lah. I think one group did on the SME, small and medium enterprise. Okay. So you need to check, okay, how are you going to, so maybe you need to contact the pendaftar syarikat, apa, Suruhanjaya pendaftar ROC ke something, Registrar of Company, okay. If you want to know how many SMEs are registered in that particular area, okay. So if you need, I think that information also is easy to obtain, okay. Contact the Registrar of Companies in that particular area. And you want just the number alone. So because I want you to put to state, okay, where this information comes from. Okay, so that is, I think, the only difficult part lah, okay, about this project, okay, that you need to get the information. Okay, but if you're doing on UUM, SAAB or UUM as a whole, I think shouldn't be that much of a problem. Okay, so I think that